Hello and a very good evening. You're watching the news at 6 on Rajya Sabha Television with me, Frank Pereira. Here are the headlines. Prime Minister Narendra Modi returns to New Delhi after concluding three-nation tour of Portugal, US and the Netherlands. Pakistan reacts to Indo-US joint statements, says Washington is talking New Delhi's language. Former Lok Sabha Speaker and five-time Lok Sabha MP Meera Kumar files nomination papers for presidential polls. Congress President Sonia Gandhi calls upcoming contest a fight of ideology, principle and truth. Rajya Sabha Chairman Mohammad Hamid Ansari administers oath of office secrecy to new members. BJP MP Bhavnan Singh from Manipur and Biju Janata Dal MP Pratap Keshri Deb from Odisha. And amid the border standoff, Beijing uses its state-run media to call India unruly, claims that while China usually avoids making an issue of border disputes, New Delhi can't afford a showdown. Prime Minister Narendra Modi returned home after concluding his three-nation tour of Portugal, the United States and the Netherlands. The highlight of his four-day trip was the U.S. leg of the visit, where he met President Donald Trump for the first time. But 2 days after the meeting between Prime Minister Modi and President Trump, Pakistan has accused the U.S. of speaking India's language and of dual standards on the issue of Kashmir. The Indo-U.S. joint statement had sternly urged Islamabad to ensure that its territory is not used to launch terrorist attacks on other countries. Responding to this, Pakistan's Interior Minister Chaudhry Nisar said, and I quote, "It seems as though the blood of Kashmiris is not at all important to the US and international laws relating to human rights do not apply to Kashmir. Ignoring the worst form of state terrorism does not only mock justice and international norms, but also exposes the dual standards of those upholding human and democratic rights," unquote. Pakistan has also slammed Hizbul Mujahideen chief Syed Salahuddin being named a global terrorist by the U.S. as completely unjustified. Both the Indo-U.S. joint statement and the U.S. action on Salahuddin are being seen as a major diplomatic victory for India, which has long accused Pakistan of backing terror in India and more specifically in Kashmir. Well, opposition candidate Meera Kumar today filed her nomination papers for the presidential elections. Meera Kumar was jointly fielded by 17 opposition parties, including the UPA, against NDA's candidate Ram Nath Kovind.
Former Lok Sabha Speaker and five-time Lok Sabha MP Meera Kumar filed her nomination for the presidential polls on Wednesday. She filed her papers in the presence of top Congress leaders, including party president Sonia Gandhi and former Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh. Backed by 17 opposition parties, Meera Kumar will contest against NDA's candidate Ram Nath Kovind. She said the election will be a battle of ideologies based on democratic values, inclusiveness in society and freedom of the press and individuals.
Hamari ladai jo hum hamesha rekhankit karte rahe hain ki vichardhara ki ladai hai वो शुरू हो जाती है देश चौराहे पर खड़ा है एक ओर का रास्ता हमें ले जाता है उस ओर जहां संकीर्णता है तंग दिली है तंग विचार है और गरीबों और दलितों और दबे हुए लोगों की कोई सोच नहीं है दूसरा रास्ता हमें ले जाता है उस तरफ जहां जो दलित हैं गरीब हैं कमजोर हैं मजलूम हैं महिलाएं हैं उनकी गरिमा उनके अधिकार उनके विकास की हम बात करें
Standing alongside Meera Kumar on Wednesday were NCP's Sharad Pawar, CPIM General Secretary Sitaram Yechuri, Trinamool Congress leader Derek O'Brien and leaders from the DMK, SP, BSP, RJD and JMM.
हम लोग के लिए एक विचारधारा असूलों और सच्चाई के लिए लड़ाए और लड़ेंगे।
हम खड़े हैं उस तरफ जो संविधान की रक्षा करके मजबूत करना चाहते हैं, दूसरी तरफ खड़े हैं वो जो संविधान की बुनियाद को ही वो जो है कमजोर करना चाहते हैं, लड़ाई वो है।
मीरा कुमार विल स्टार्ट हर कैंपेन फ्रॉम गुजरात साबरमती आश्रम फ्रॉम फ्राइडे। शी विल ऑल्सो विजिट मुंबई, बैंगलोर एंड बिहार बिफोर रैपिंग अप हर कैंपेन ऑन जुलाई 15th, टू डेज बिफोर द इलेक्शंस। Voting for the election for the 15th President of India will take place on July 17th. The results will be declared on July 20th. With Navikram Singh and Vishal Daya, Ravindra Sharan's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Union Minister Venkaiah Naidu filed another set of nomination papers on behalf of the NDA's presidential nominee Ramnath Kovind on the last day of filing nominations for the presidential elections today. Naidu was accompanied by YSR Congress leader Rajamohan Reddy and BJP leader and Parliamentary Affairs Minister Anant Kumar. Kovind is currently campaigning across the country for the July 17th polls.
केवल हमारा 33 political parties जो NDA में है, उसके अलावा 5 political parties जो NDA के बाहर है, वो लोग भी समर्थन देने के लिए घोषणा किया है।
राज्यसभा स्पीकर मोहम्मद हामिद अंसारी ऑन वेडनेसडे एडमिनिस्टर्ड द ओथ ऑफ ऑफिस एंड सीक्रेसी टू 2 न्यू मेंबर्स, बीजेपी एमपी भावनंद सिंह फ्रॉम मणिपुर एंड बीजू जनता दल एमपी प्रताप केशरी देव फ्रॉम ओडिशा। द सेरेमनी वॉज कंडक्टेड एट द राज्यसभा चेयरपर्सन चेंबर इन पार्लियामेंट हाउस।
Rajyasabha Chairman Mohammad Hamid Ansari on Wednesday administered the oath to new members of the House, K. Bhavanand Singh of the BJP and Pratap Keshri Deb of the BJD. After the oath-taking ceremony, Bhavanand Singh, who is also the Manipur State BJP President, said resolving internal problems and raising issues relating to his state will be his first priority. He also listed providing job opportunities to the youth as the most important task at hand. This is the first time that the BJP has a member from Manipur in the Rajya Sabha.
लेकिन employment का तो जरूर है, लेकिन employment तो generate करना पड़ेगा. We have to empower the people. We can't just create jobs. So we have to do such a way that we empower the people to get like skill development is there. So we have to put emphasis on that.
BJD leader Pratap Keshri Deb was elected uncontested from Odisha. While Bhavananda took the oath in Manipuri, Pratap Keshri Deb did so in his language, Odia. Leader of the House Arun Jaitley and MOS Parliamentary Affairs Mukhtar Abbas Naqvi were also present at the ceremony. Ravindra Sharan's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, as India and China are busy trading accusations of intrusion into each other's territory, a state-run Chinese daily on Wednesday claimed India needs to be taught the rules of dealing with the border disputes. Meanwhile, China warned India that future visits of its pilgrims to Kailash Mansarovar through the Nathla Pass will depend on whether India mends its ways.
The border standoff continues between India and China, even as Beijing used its state-run media to call India unruly and said it needs to be taught the rules. An opinion piece published by Chinese daily Global Times claimed that China usually avoids making an issue of border disputes. The article also said India can't afford a showdown with China on border issues. Besides calling India arrogant, the tabloid said India's GDP was only a quarter of China's. But it asserted that China had no desire to confront India. In another development, China justified road construction in Sikkim, claiming that the area was undoubtedly located on its side of the border under the 1890 Sino-British Treaty. On Tuesday, China lodged a diplomatic protest with India, accusing Indian troops of crossing the boundary in the Sikkim region and demanded their immediate withdrawal.
和新德里都已经向印度方面提出了严正的交涉，表明了我们的严正的立场。我在这必须强调，中方对发展中印友好关系是有诚意的，同时中方维护自身主权权益的立场也是坚定不移的。The
Chinese statement comes a day after the Chinese military accused Indian troops of objecting to a road construction in what it claimed to be Chinese territory. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, the first batch of 2,000 pilgrims left the Jammu base camp on Wednesday for this year's Amarnath Yatra that starts on June 29th. State Deputy Chief Minister Nirmal Singh flagged off the annual pilgrimage. Singh said that the government had taken necessary steps to provide the best facilities to the devotees during the 40-day-long Yatra. Following intelligence reports stating a terror threat, highest level of security is in force for the Yatra. Thousands of security personnel have been deployed on the route. The pilgrims also expressed confidence in the army and the government for their arrangements. The Yatra will conclude on August 7th.
कोई इस प्रकार की बात नहीं होगी जिसमें कि यात्रा में बाधा आए, इसकी गारंटी जो है सरकार देती है। हमने बहुत से हजारों की तादाद में सुरक्षा कर्मी इसके लिए लगाए हुए हैं, जिसमें हमारी सेना है, सुरक्षा बल हैं, हमारी पुलिस जम्मू कश्मीर की पुलिस है, सारे डिपार्टमेंट इसमें लगे हुए हैं और इस पर अच्छे प्रबंध हैं।
हमें डर नहीं लगा बिल्कुल भी, हमने तो जाना है। बाबा की इतनी मौज है कि डटा ही नहीं जा रहा बिल्कुल भी कि कब दर्शन करें।
बहुत खुशी हो रही है और मैं आपको बताऊं कि हमारा देश, हमारी आर्मी और हमारी सरकार, इस पे हमें पूरा गर्व है और हमें भरोसा है कि हमारी सुरक्षा करेगी, इसलिए मन में ऐसा कहीं कुछ भी नहीं है।
Let's now take a look at some more developments from across the country and nationwide. Mumbai serial blast case convict Mustafa Dosa died of cardiac arrest in Mumbai on Wednesday. Dosa was hospitalized after he complained of chest pain, hypertension and diabetes. He was convicted along with five others in the second leg of the trial in the 1993 serial blast case. The prosecution had alleged that Dosa was one of the brains behind the conspiracy and that his responsibility towards the commission of the crime was the highest. West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee expressed her concern over the implementation of GST. She said after the demonetization exercise, the urgency in pushing GST through is another epic blunder by the centre. She added that the economy is not yet ready to face the GST from July 1st. Mamata said her party will not attend the midnight programme at Parliament House on June 30th to announce the rollout of GST. Two unidentified men hurled paper missiles inside the Delhi Assembly House while a session was underway and raised Inqilab Zindabad slogans. The two men were later taken away by the security. The two men, who claimed to be AAP workers, said that they took the step as they were unhappy with the Arvind Kejriwal-led party and alleged corruption cases against Delhi Minister Satyendra Jain. The CBI on Wednesday took over investigation of the 500 crore rupees online Ponzi scam. The scam involves some companies that allegedly took money from people by luring them with promise of lucrative payments for every click on advertisements on their website. The probe agency took the complaint on directives from the Allahabad High Court. It's time for a short break now, but news updates will continue on the other side. Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
What is BJP without Narendra Modi?
Modi ji is not separate from BJP.
There is an effort to homogenize the society into a Hindutva society based on the hatred for Muslims.
We have not imposed anything on the people. So our track record is the answer.
For the current government, Kashmir is only about Pakistan and terrorism.
People sitting in Delhi studios should understand that Kashmir is not a political issue.
Watch To The Point with National General Secretary of BJP, Ram Madhav, only on Rajya Sabha Television.
Bhagat Singh Sardar, Surma Bhagat Singh Sardar.
one of the most influential revolutionaries of Indian freedom struggle, Shaheed Bhagat Singh. Born into a Sikh family, patriotism flowed in his blood at the age of 13. When he formed Naujawan Bharat Sabha to spread the message of revolution in Punjab. In the wake of avenging Lala Lajpat Rai's death, Bhagat Singh and his associates coined the catchphrase Inqilab Zindabad. But towards the end of their rebellion, they had to pay a heavy price for their patriotism. Following the blasts inside the corridors of the assembly, both Bhagat Singh and Batukeshwar Dutt courted arrest. Bhagat Singh was sent to the gallows in Lahore with his fellow comrades, after which he was cremated in Husainiwala on the banks of Satluj.
Tales that inspire. Stories of social change. A salute to diversity. Promoting public discourse. Events that motivate. Inspiring the innovative spirit. Watch Rajya Sabha television documentaries.
Welcome back, you're watching Rajya Sabha Television. Well, Qatar has condemned Saudi Arabia for its refusal to negotiate the demands that it has made for ending a crippling embargo on the emirate. After holding talks with U.S. Secretary of State Rex Tillerson in Washington, Qatari Foreign Minister Sheikh Mohammed bin Abdul Rahman Al Thani said that the Saudi position was unacceptable. Sheikh Mohammed said Saudi Arabia's refusal to negotiate goes against all principles that govern international relations. Saudi Arabia has been unbudging over the three-week-old dispute isolating Qatar under a trade and diplomatic embargo set by its Arab neighbors. Saudi Foreign Minister Adel Al-Jubeir reiterated on Twitter that the 13 demands that have been set out are non-negotiable and that now it was up to Qatar to end its support for extremism and terrorism. Rex Tillerson also met Kuwaiti Minister of State for Cabinet Affairs, Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah Al Sabah. Kuwait has been trying a mediating role in the rift between the Gulf nations. Well, the U.S. State Department placed China on its this year's global list of the worst offenders in human trafficking. Now, the report states that China does not fully meet the minimum standards for the elimination of trafficking. The agency also included Sudan and North Korea in the list. However, the agency's 2017 report upgraded the statutes of Myanmar, Afghanistan, Malaysia and Qatar while leaving those of Russia, Cuba and Thailand unchanged. The department dropped Iraq and Myanmar from countries that recruit and use child soldiers. The report sorts countries into three tiers, with tier 3 being the worst and tier 1 the best, based on how well the government acknowledges and deals with human trafficking problems in its country.
China was downgraded to tier 3 status in this year's report, in part because it has not taken serious steps to end its own complicity in trafficking, including forced laborers from North Korea that are located in China.
Well, companies across the globe are reporting that they have been struck by a major ransomware cyber attack. Hackers launched a blistering ransomware attacks against companies and agencies across the world, particularly targeting Ukrainian businesses. Major global firms reported that they had been targeted, including British advertising agency WPP, Russian oil and gas giant Rosneft, and Danish shipping firm Maersk. The Chernobyl nuclear power plant has also had to monitor radiation levels manually after its Windows-based sensors were shut down. The virus freezes the user's computer until a ransom is paid. The U.S. Department of Homeland Security advised victims not to pay the ransom, saying there was no guarantee that access to files would be restored. The source of the attack is not yet clear. It is similar to WannaCry, which spread globally in May, but there are differences. Many firms have suggested that the ransomware is a variant of Petya, a known ransomware. The international police organization Interpol has said that it was closely monitoring the situation. There are likely close to 2,000 attacks due to recent ransomware attack, most in Ukraine, Russia and Poland.
По всій країні багато підприємств, як державного, так і приватного сектору, сьогодні практично в один той самий час були уражені вірусом, дуже подібним до вірусу «Вона край», який блокує файли на комп'ютерах. Але енергосистема працює в порядку, ми зараз з вами на диспетчерському щиті.
It looks horribly like it might be using something very similar to the WannaCry ransomware that we saw. So this isn't people clicking on a link in an email and getting their computers infected. This looks like there's some automated mechanism spreading this. There's two possible mechanisms it seems to be narrowed down to at the moment, but it's spreading extremely fast.
The European Union has handed Google a record-breaking $2.7 billion fine, the biggest fine imposed by Europe on any company ever. The EU accuses the search engine for illegally favoring its own shopping service as customers use Google to search for products online. European regulators said that by artificially and illegally promoting its own price comparison service in searches, Google denied both its consumers real choice and rival firms the ability to compete on a level playing field. The Silicon Valley giant has 90 days to stop its illegal activities and explain how it will reform its ways. The EU regulator is further investigating how else the company may have abused its position, specifically in its provision of maps, images and information on local services. Google, however, has disputed the EU's findings and said that it is considering an appeal. The search giant maintains that its shopping service helps consumers and advertisers.
Today, the Commission has decided to fine Google €2.4 billion for breaching EU antitrust rules. Google has abused its market dominance as a search engine by giving illegal advantages to another Google product, its shopping comparison service. Google must end this conduct within 90 days or face penalty payments.
Let's now take a look at some more developments from across the globe in Global Buzz. A Venezuelan helicopter launched an attack on the country's Supreme Court in Caracas on Tuesday. The helicopter was reportedly piloted by an officer in the country's investigative police force, Oscar Perez. President Nicolas Maduro condemned the attack in a televised address, saying terrorists were behind the offensive. The police officer later released a statement denouncing the criminal government. Another landslide struck a village in southwestern China on Tuesday, where rescue workers are looking for nearly 100 people buried over the last weekend. No further casualties were reported in the second landslide, as the area where the village once stood was evacuated on Monday. Germany's parliament plans to vote on a bill to legalize same-sex marriage on Friday after the lower house legislative committee put it on the agenda. The bill is widely expected to pass as it is backed by most parties. Chancellor Angela Merkel has told lawmakers of her center-right party that they can vote according to their conscience. Moving on to some sports news now, where India's top singles tennis player Ramkumar Ramanathan recorded the biggest win of his singles career as he stunned world number 8 Dominic Thiem in the pre-quarterfinals of the Antalya Open. The world's 222nd ranked Ramanathan, who entered the tournament through the qualifiers, dominated the match throughout against the tournament top-seeded Thiem, winning 6-2, 6-3 in under an hour. This was Ramanathan's first ever victory over a top 10 player in the ATP rankings. He will next face veteran Cyprus star Marcos Bagdaitis in the quarterfinals. Here's a roundup of the other sports news in Sports Beat. Former South African batsman Gary Kirsten says that he is not in the race to be the coach for the Indian cricket team. Kirsten's name has been cited as one of the possible choices since he has already coached India from 2008 to 2011 and capped a successful tenure with the World Cup triumph in 2011. Lasith Malinga has been suspended for a year after the fast bowler pleaded guilty to a breach of contract by speaking without permission to the media. Malinga appeared before the Sri Lankan Cricket Special Inquiry Panel and tendered a formal apology. He'll also be fined 50% of the match fee for the next one-day international. U.S. gymnastics investigator Deborah Daniels has alleged that the number of athletes victimized in the sport is far higher than the hundreds previously reported. She said the organization needs a complete culture change to protect young people from predatory adults who gain access to them under the cover of mentorship and counseling. Well, that's it on this newscast.